Welcome to the Run for God Run Club, where you will find God in a runner's space.
Welcome to the Run for God Run Club. This is your one stop each week to be motivated and inspired to get off the couch and onto the running trail, where you can, in turn, inspire others to do the same. Let's learn, laugh, and leap into running together, giving God the glory for what we are able to do in His name. Amen. I am your running host, Dean Thompson. Today, we ask the question, why do people run on purpose? And we may find out that it is His purpose. Then I'm going to share my thoughts on mountaintop experiences. How should we look at them? As Christian runners, I mean. And joining me once again is Run for God founder Mitchell Hollis.
You know, when you ask me about, or when you say the phrase people running on purpose, what is, I want to take a one person poll here. What is the number one thing you hear from non-runners when you say that you are a runner?
Why would you do that?
No. They say, well, if you ever see me running,
yeah,
you better run too, because there's something chasing me.
That's true.
Yeah. Now, I don't know why that made me think of that. How's your week been, Dean?
It's been really good. You know, I had a race this weekend.
Yeah, how'd it go?
Went down to Atlanta and ran the...
That was a 5K, right?
The USATF Masters National Championship. Yeah. And our team got third.
Really?
So we were the Chattanooga Track Club. We were third behind the Atlanta Track Club. And the Atlanta Track Club, they're one and
they're
two.
They're A team and B team.
We fortunately beat their C team, so to get on the podium. So anyway, it was fun. I finished third. I was a little disappointed in myself, but I feel like I should have won.
So it was on the track.
No. This was on the road.
Oh, it was on the road.
This was the road championships. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's in conjunction with the Publix marathon and half marathon.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So anyway, that's what I've been doing. But it was really hard. You know, I've been doing all this long training to getting ready for this 100 mile or so to do something short and fast. Gosh, it was so hard. And I think when I finished, I was like, I could have ran harder.
Yeah.
But you feel like you're running so hard because you haven't been doing that. And so anyway, like I said, I was a little disappointed, but I was 7 seconds away from winning my age group.
Right.
And finished third. So,
well, hey, you mentioned the Publix half marathon. Don't forget, for everybody out there listening, on April the 29th, we are kicking off the we're having a live kickoff the Monday evenings, 8 o'clock p.m. on April the 29th for a live kickoff of the half marathon challenge that will also graduate at the St. Petersburg Marathon weekend. In 2025 with the Couch to Marathon group that's going on right now. So that's pretty cool that we're lining these up. We have made the decision. We're also going to have a 10K challenge that'll start a little later in the year and a 5K challenge that will all finish at the St. Petersburg Marathon weekend. So that's going to be really cool. So we're going to have people there. We typically have people of all distances there anyway, at these graduation Couch to Marathons, but we're going to be intentional about it this year. So if you missed the Couch to Marathon start date, number one, depending on how much you're running, you could probably still jump in there if you're running a little bit right now. But if you want to put April the 29th on your calendar and join us live, we'll be on the national Facebook page doing the live, kind of like we did for the Couch to Marathon. Mm-hmm. But we would love to have you jump in the Couch to Half Marathon that will finish in St. Petersburg, Florida, or a race in your community. You don't have to come to the races that we all graduate at. That's just kind of where we have a meetup during the year where we all get together, and they're always great.
Yeah.
We were in Mississippi this past year. I wasn't there, but our team was there, and it's always a special time.
It really is.
You guys came back with some stories, and it's stories just like we hear every year.
Yeah.
The stories of triumph, friendships. That's where the magic happens in this club, is when participants get together to meet each other. And so I can't wait.
Absolutely. Yep. Hey, you know what else is coming up? This podcast right here may be the podcast that puts us over 100,000 downloads since we began this thing. Isn't that crazy?
That is so crazy.
Wow.
I mean, it's so... It just lets me know that God can do whatever he wants. Because
for sure.
These two boys, yeah. We couldn't have made that happen. There's just no way.
Yeah.
But it's very humbling. It's exciting. It's encouraging that people actually want to listen to what you and I are sitting here talking about. And yeah.
So thank you to you for listening.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. So our post this week comes from Madonna Barker, who coincidentally is also the person who wrote the story for this week. So I thought it was cool. But this post also comes from Strava. We normally share something from Facebook or Run Club Social, but I thought, let's try something.
And you know, Madonna's mom was the second person to ever get one of the Run for God walking shirts.
That's right.
You know, Val and Tom Bleakley came here from Northern Ireland.
That's right.
And I had met Madonna's mom the day before, and she was talking about how, or actually the same day, she's just a walker. You know, they always put that just. I'm just a walker. And I said, well, you're not just a walker, you're a walker, and I've got something for you. So that night we got to present her with a walking shirt. So anyway, I didn't mean to run over you there, Dean.
Yeah. Well, she writes this, morning run. Sometimes you get distracted in life and get tripped up. Happened on my run this morning. Tripped on an uneven sidewalk at 2.3 miles. But you have to get up and finish. Thankful for this 5.25 miler. Keep on going. God will always be there for us. Not going to lie, I'm hurting. Enjoy this beautiful day. Hmm. And then a bunch of hashtags.
That's that good hurting, though.
Yeah. Well,
I mean, even if you fall down, it's just you did it doing something, which is in a weird, twisted kind of way, as my wife might say, it's satisfying.
Yeah, yeah. I think I've told the story before about being in Hawaii. Mm-hmm. Debbie and I are on vacation in Hawaii, but I need to get in a good, hard tempo run. Mm-hmm. And so I'm doing my tempo run. I'm running along pretty fast pace. I'm probably running 5:30-something pace. And I hit a crack. It wasn't a crack in a sidewalk, but it was on a paved road where there was a crack. And I hit that, and I mean, I went flying through the air. I wore glasses. I had to wear glasses at that time, and my glasses flew off my face. I'm looking around. I can't find them when I'm getting up. And I look, and I realize I'm right at an intersection, and I'm right at a light.
And you can't see.
And there, all these people are stopped at this light. You know how many people asked me how I was? Not zero. The first one. Nobody even opened their window and said, hey, are you okay? But all these people saw
me. Not encouraging about the state of humanity is what you're saying.
Oh, no. But I got back. I finally found my glasses, crawled over to my glasses, put them back on, got back up, and finished my run. Yeah. I did not finish my tempo run. I did finish my run, though. I was hurting pretty bad. I hit that ground pretty hard. So I understand what she's talking about there.
Yeah, I do too. I've had one of those falls where it feels like it takes you 10 minutes to hit the ground.
Yep.
I've had one of those too.
Yeah, yeah. But her point is that, you know, this happens in life too, right?
Sure.
We get tripped up on things and we get distracted. Crazy things happen. You know, it's why I know you get frustrated with the reminders on my cell phone, but that's why I set them, because I get busy doing something else, and if I don't interrupt myself, then I probably won't get it done. And our other point here is, you know, we need to keep going when you get tripped up, when things don't go well. We need to keep going.
Well, and you got to understand, we can't fall into the trap of throwing our hands up either. We're all going to hit snags. We're all going to miss things. We're all going to miss workouts. We're all going to miss that thing that we were supposed to get done. But she, just like Madonna, she got up, probably dusted her knees off from the asphalt buried in her knees or whatever it was, and she kept going.
Yeah.
But so many times we want to just lay there in the middle of the road, mm-hmm. you know, using your example, and we can't do that. We need to learn something from what happened, and we need to continue on, and we'll be better for it. But a lot of times we get down and we want to wallow there for a while, and can't do that.
Yeah, we do.
If you lay there in the middle of the road and you wallow, what's going to happen? You're going to get hit by a truck.
Eventually.
And so, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's a good point. I remember, sometimes that thing that hits you wallops you pretty hard, and sometimes you do have to stop for a little bit.
Sure.
That happens. You know, I remember having a stress fracture back, I don't know, 13 years ago, I think it is now. And I had to stop running for a little while.
Yeah.
But I was eager to get back to it once I got through.
Sure.
With that thing. Whatever that thing is that gets in your way, just get up and keep going. Trivia question from last week. Back in 1978, there was a guy who set world records in the 3,000 meters, the 3,000 meter steeplechase, the 5,000 meters, and the 10,000 meters in 81 days. Who was that man? This is widely considered one of the greatest short spans in anybody's running career ever. His name was Henry Rono. Henry Rono came from, he was a Kenyan that came over here from Kenya back when it wasn't as popular for Kenyans to come over here and train. This is what it says. It says, the peak of Rono's running career was the 1978 season. In a span of only 81 days, he broke four world records. He ran 27:22 in the 10,000 meters, 13:08 in the 5,000 meters, 8:05 in the 3,000 meter steeplechase, and ran 7:32 in the 3,000 meters. He lowered the 10,000 record by almost 8 seconds, the 5,000 by 4.5, the steeplechase by 2.6, and the 3,000 by a full 3 seconds.
Wow.
His steeplechase record stood for 11 years and is still to this day the NCAA record for the steeplechase. If somebody runs 8:05 today, that is an elite performance, and you're almost certainly in the Olympics even today.
Really?
And this is back in 1978.
Why do you think that is, that 46 years later this record has it? That's almost unheard of nowadays.
I think he was just that good. He was just that good.
So the super shoes and all that stuff hasn't helped the steeplechase any.
Well, it has helped the steeplechase. The world record is faster. But he was such an outlier. You know, the world record now is 7:52.
Oh, okay. You said NCAA record.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay,
I thought
you were talking about the world record still stands, and that's just unheard of.
This was the NCAA record. And I mean, today, if somebody runs 8:15 in the NCAA, they're great. They're going to place.
Right.
And he ran 8:05 back in 1978. So he came to the U.S. in 1976 to attend Washington State University in Pullman, Washington. Again, he was one of several Kenyans who ran at Washington State back in that time. UTEP, University of Texas El Paso, was another team that had a lot of Kenyan runners back in that day. And I think UTEP usually won the national championships in cross country. But you had Henry Rono, who won three NCAA titles. Hmm. He's one of only three people to have done that. He is actually the last person to have done it, because the other two are Jerry Lindgren, who did it in the 60s, and then Steve Prefontaine, who did it right around 1970. Ironically, he still has the fastest time for the 10K cross country as well. 28:07 that he ran. Now, they've been really, really close to that several times.
So he still holds the NCAA
cross country
10K record.
Yep.
Wow.
Yep. Now, the race was only run one time in that particular city, and so I don't know if that course was super fast. I don't know. I know that today a lot of the races are held on hilly courses that are tough to run fast times on.
Do you think they were as exact back then? Because, you know, now they're just so exact with measuring courses, tangents, things like that. You think that was it as exact back then? You did?
Yeah. I mean, I was around back then. I remember measuring courses back then. Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know if the standards were exactly the same as far as the rules for how you measured a course, but they measured it and went to the foot.
Yeah. Okay.
Anyway, this was the first time in 1976 when he won that first NCAA championship. Again, that's still the fastest time ever. 28:07. The race was 6 miles up until then, and they changed it to 10K in 1976. And he won in 76, 77, and 79. Isn't that weird that the one year he didn't win was 1978 when he set those four world records? Yes.
So let me ask you this. This thought just came into my head, because I was thinking about, you know, that cross country is really the level playing field, because, you know, we talk about track surfaces and things like that. Well, cross country is the great equalizer. But are super shoes, do they really help you as much? I know they don't help you as much as on the track or on the road in cross country, but do they help you as much in cross country conditions? You know how we've talked about the reason a lot of the records are so much better now is because
of the shoes.
Conditions, track conditions, and super shoes.
Yeah.
Well, do they really help you at all in a 5K or 10K cross country?
Yeah, it's a good question. I would say they help a little, but not as much.
Yeah.
Because obviously tracks are better, the surfaces are better. And,
well, because cross country, the surface is just so much cushion anyway. And the springiness of those super shoes, I would say, would a lot of that just goes in the ground.
Yeah.
You know, when it's that
soft. I would think so. Yeah. It's a good point.
Yeah.
Well, poor Henry Rono never got to run in the Olympics. Kenya boycotted the 1976 and the 1980 Olympics, so he never got a chance to run in the Olympics. He went after that. He coached at Albuquerque, at a high school in Albuquerque for a little while. He helped at Washington State for a little while. He stayed around running. When he was 55, he thought he would break the Masters record for the mile. And started training for that, but he never did it. But there was a whole lot of a buzz around it when he decided to try to do that back around the year, somewhere around 2000. But he died a few weeks ago. I wanted to do a trivia question with him because he died just a few weeks ago. And there's one story, a legendary story about Henry Rono that is still, he calls it his greatest race ever. It's not one of those four world records. Alberto Salazar wanted to break the American record in the 10,000 meters, and so he was calling everybody he knew who could push him to run a fast time to try to get them to get in this race. The shoe company sponsor was also really wanted Henry Rono in it because it was a big name and they could push it. The problem was Henry Rono wasn't in shape. I think he knew like 40 days from this race, and he basically started getting in shape like 40 days out. He ran a 5K the week before and got beat in the 5K. But he shows up for this 10K, and he and Alberto Salazar basically ran shoulder to shoulder the entire way, ran away from everybody else, and Henry Rono outkicked him by a tenth of a second in the last 100 meters. And in the video,
so he beat the guy that wanted him there.
And if you want to go back, I think there's some pictures somewhere. Henry Rono had a beer gut at the time. He was 20 pounds overweight. And Alberto Salazar missed the American record by 1 second, and Henry Rono beat him that day, being in not great shape. He was just one of those guys who could just. It didn't matter. It didn't matter whether he was in. He could just run fast. He just had. I think his mental game was just the best.
I don't know why that takes me back to. Gosh, I don't remember when it was. 2006, maybe, when Michigan paid App State like $5 million to come to town so they could beat up on them.
Yeah.
And then App State beat them.
Yeah.
Number one team in the nation.
Yeah. Well, this was a little different because Henry Rono was a big name. But
to your point, he had a beer gut. He'd been training for 40 days to get in shape for this. It should not have happened.
That's right. Yeah.
Otherwise, Salazar probably wouldn't have invited him.
That's correct. Yeah. You're right. But anyway, Henry Rono, he was a legend.
So the question is, was Salazar, did he just, obviously he had a bad race, but was it that bad that Henry Rono beat him, or did just Henry Rono have an incredible race, and Salazar was a little off that day?
Salazar was less than a second off the American record.
So it was just that epic of a race.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'd like to see that.
It was great. Yep.
I don't guess there's videos of that race, is there?
I tried to find it. I didn't see it, but I didn't look for long. Yeah. So.
Cool.
Upward Sports equips churches to run self-sustaining sports ministries in their communities. Whether you're a sports fanatic or on staff at a church, Upward Sports will give you all the tools you need to run a first-class sports ministry that allows you to reach families in your community. Upward Sports offers basketball, soccer, flag football, cheerleading, volleyball, baseball, and softball through league and camp offerings. At Upward Sports, we want to help your church make a difference and give you increased opportunities to share the gospel. Learn more today at upward.org. That's upward.org.
All right, we're back. And, you know, I got a flood of stories here recently, which was good. And we're going to go over one of those stories today. But we still need more because we do this every week. We got to have at least one a week. Yeah. So keep sending in your stories. Remember, you have a story. It doesn't matter if you don't think you do. You do. And I'm sure that if you rub your brain cells together, you'll figure out how to put that down on paper in words. And if it's not perfect, don't worry about it.
So did you get any stories, and maybe you hadn't read through them all yet? You know, we asked for somebody to submit a story pre-starting the Couch to Marathon training. Did you get any of those?
I did not get any of those. I did get one that talked about her journey to the marathon in Mississippi.
Okay. So we just talked a little while ago about the end of April, we're starting the half marathon challenge. Mm-hmm. So we got many weeks to go before then. If you're thinking you're going to start the half marathon challenge with us, send us your story now with your thoughts. I want to hear some stories of what is going through people's heads prior to starting one of these challenges.
That'd be great.
And then to hear the difference, because we hear it talking to people. We know the contrast, but I would love to have that kind of archived in our podcast library of pre and post one of these challenges, because the difference is dramatic.
Yeah.
We know because we hear the stories, we talk to people, but we've never had that submitted. So
yeah.
If you're out there, I'm challenging you. If you're going to sign up for the half marathon challenge, or if you're just signing up for any of the monthly national 5K challenges that start every month, send your story, write your story, reduce it to writing before you start, and then let's hear back from you after your start. It's a good way to get two of your stories on the podcast in one calendar year.
That's right. That'd be great. Well, an interesting thing happened in Pennsylvania. Drew Bosley is the best high school runner in the nation right now. He's just broke the record for the fastest ever 2-miler. He ran 8:38 for 2 miles, not 3,200 meters, 2 miles. And he's run 4:02 for the mile as well. But the state of Pennsylvania has a rule. And if you don't run a meet with other high school, with only other high school runners in it, you can't compete at the state meet. Now, we're talking about the indoor season right now. Mm-hmm. So he is not going to be able to run in the Pennsylvania indoor state meet, which he won last year.
Mm-hmm.
Because the only races he has run, he's run with professionals in the race. Mm. So he's gone out there and he's raced and he's run these fast times, but he can't run in his state meet. What are your thoughts on that?
We've talked about these types of situations before. I mean, my thought is he knew the rule.
Mm-hmm.
His coach knew the rule.
The bad part is it's the athlete who suffers. It's the coach's fault. Athlete suffers.
Is it? I mean, the athlete, I have to think that he knew this was the rule. And that at some point, him and his dad and or mom and the coach made a cognitive decision at some point and said, we're going to go this route.
Yeah.
And that just has to have happened. I mean, I know from coaching high school kids.
Totally agree.
We have these conversations, and then it's like they're coming back after the fact and saying, well, can you make an exception? And so, I don't know. It stinks because, I mean, from a spectator, we would love to see, you know, him run this race.
Well, I have a little bit different take on this, because this happened to me as a coach.
Yeah.
I had an athlete who qualified for a national championship race.
Right.
And she it was in the marathon, and the marathon is connected to the track meet. And I knew I had to do some things to enter somebody in a track meet, but this was a marathon. And so in my mind, I kind of sent an email, and I got the impression that everything was done. I didn't need to do anything. Well, in the rule book, it tells you what you need to do. It's very clear. My fault. Mm-hmm. I didn't read the rule book, but I had to go in, and like it would take me like seriously less than a minute to go in there and do what I needed to do. It's just something I just needed to click a box, basically. And I didn't do it. and I had a short window of time to do it, and I missed the window. And so I went to him and I said, look, I didn't know I had to do this. It's the marathon. It's a little bit different than a track meet. And I didn't realize I had to do it. And, you know, can we go ahead and get her in there? And they told me no. They said the only way you could, I appealed. I lost the appeal. They told me the only way you can do it is for you to pay over $1,000 fine. And then you can get her in there. So it cost me over $1,000 because I wasn't going to go back to the athlete and say, I messed up. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And so from a coaching standpoint, I get it.
Yeah.
But when the athlete has to suffer, I was willing to pay over $1,000 because I made a mistake. And because I couldn't stand the thought of the athlete not getting a chance because of my boneheaded mistake.
Yeah, I mean, there's the whole rule part, but there's also the... I mean, I'm thinking back to when Lane was running track and he was coming up through the ranks in triathlon. And we had this discussion a lot about the whole, if you're going to run track, you're going to run track with your track team. You're going to be at the practices. Lane didn't have to be at the practices. I mean, he was fit enough and doing plenty of other stuff that he could have showed up on track meets and did what his coach wanted him to do, you know, performed well. And probably won a lot of them.
Yeah.
He didn't have to be at practice to do that because he had a training regimen outside of the organized school. But I never – I said, if you're going to run track, you're going to run track. You're going to be at practices. You're going to run with your team. Now, do you want to do a different workout? Okay, then your whole team needs to do the workout, you know. And we, luckily, I kind of knew the distance coach, which was you. And so we always made it work, but we made it work to where he was part of the team. What I don't like, and you've heard me say this before, is for an athlete who is so good that they don't participate in the team and they show up when it counts, which I know there's a lot of coaches out there would be like, yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
I don't like the culture of that.
Yeah, I get that.
And so, I don't know. And I don't know if that's what Drew was going on with Drew.
Yeah, we don't know any of the details.
We don't know the details, but I tend to fall on the side of, I have to think they knew this was the rule.
Yeah.
And they tried to slide in at the last minute and... So I don't know.
It's an interesting thought anyway.
I'm a rule follower. Yeah. A rule follower. Now I'm not bashful to challenge the rules. I would have probably done what his coach and dad did.
Yeah.
I would try my darndest.
Yeah.
But I also know I'm probably gonna lose this.
Yeah.
But it's worth the try.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Well, and that may be their attitude toward the whole thing anyway.
Yeah. Of course the media picks it up and just blows it all out of proportion. Yeah. But anyway.
Well, how did your running journey start? This one is familiar to a lot of people. You know, a lot of people never thought they would run for running's sake, but somehow they did it anyway, and then they learned to love it. This one comes from Madonna Barker, and it's called Run on Purpose. Run on Purpose? My Run for God story actually starts 9 years before I started running. I was born with hip dysplasia, and when I was 29 years old, I began having hip pain. The pain increased, and when I was 35 years old, I had hip reconstruction on my left side. They don't usually do hip replacements on someone that young. A funny fact is that my surgery was at Nationwide Children's Hospital. The surgery was successful, but the recovery was very hard. There was no weight bearing for 7 weeks. Afterwards, I started on physical therapy. I had 5 pins in my hip for a year. At my 1 year checkup, the pins came out, and I asked my doctor what restrictions were. He said, I didn't have any. He said, in fact, you can run a marathon. I laughed at him and told him I wasn't a runner. Fast forward to May 6th, 2013, my church started the Run for God program. My friend asked me if I wanted to join with her. I responded with, run? On purpose? I don't think so. Well, she talked me into it. I thought I would give it a try, but didn't think I would ever be able to run 3 miles. I remember starting the run, walk, run workouts. It wasn't easy, but it was fun trying something new with my church friends. At the end of the 12 weeks, we ran our graduation race. What a great day. In Matthew 19:26, Jesus looked at them and said, "With man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible." Never would I ever thought I would be able to run 3.1 miles. God has certainly helped me grow in many ways through this program, physically, spiritually, and mentally. Once I completed my first 5K, I wanted to keep going. So I started training for a 10K. I fell in love with running. I love how it made me feel. I love running outside and listening to music, a podcast, or just having quiet time with God. I have met so many new friends. I love group runs. I have been encouraged by many, and I hope I have been an encouragement to others as well. The running community is so supportive. Thanks to the Run for God program, I have run 4 full marathons, 13 and counting half marathons, many 10K and 5K races. I give all the glory to God. I am very thankful. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. I have led a Run for God class. It is so exciting to watch new runners start out. I understand how they are feeling. This May will be 11 years since my running began. I hope to run as long as I can. My Run for God shirts have started many conversations with others. I hope to help as many people as I can know God and want to have a relationship with Him. Running is about much more than just running. It's about people and relationships. I look forward to helping more people with their running journey and shining my light.
Madonna's a jewel.
Yeah, she is. Yeah, I don't know what it is about this particular story, because we get so many good stories, but this one just felt like it was like straight from the heart, mm-hmm. right? Again, not that the others aren't, because they certainly are, but you almost can feel, you know, you see pictures of Madonna on social media smiling mm-hmm. all the time. You can just feel Madonna smiling while she writes.
Well, and we talked about this before we started the podcast this morning, how this is, Madonna is just a case study of what Run for God is. You know, it met a person, Run for God met a person who was not a runner, who kind of cracked jokes about running, and now she's run many marathons and many races, and she gives God the glory for all of it. She shares her experience in the process. She teaches those in her community. She's just she's the case study. She's what we look for. Mm-hmm. And Run for God, and there's many Madonnas out there is what's really cool.
Yeah.
And they take on a life of their own, their personalities, they do things differently, and that's why, you know, we have many conversations around here about, you know, the programming and things like that, and we're always very careful to leave room, some latitude for coaches, and because everybody does things differently.
Yeah.
And Madonna's just a great example of that, and great job, Madonna. Great story, by the way.
Yeah, and I like the way she talks about how running and relationships kind of go together, because they do.
Sure.
And that's, you know, the Run for God classes, that's why they thrive like they do, is because running and relationships go together. Now, there is the other side of that coin. There's, you know, there's a movie out called The Loneliness of the Long Distance Runner. That's a real thing.
Yeah,
right. But as much as I like being alone, I love it when Coe Booker comes back to town and he
sure.
sends me a text message and says, "Hey, what are you doing Saturday? You want to go for a run?"
Yeah.
I'm like, yes, yeah. I am all over that, right? Yeah. It's a good time to connect with people. But it's also the thing about running and runners is it's a good mission field.
Absolutely.
There's a lot of lost runners out there. Mm-hmm. So, scripture passage from Matthew 19:26: "With man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible." She follows that with, "I cannot imagine doing this life without God." Man, Jesus is telling his disciples here that no one can save themselves, right?
Right.
This is the rich man. He says a rich man, you know, It would be easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter heaven. And with all the what he's saying here is with all the resources that rich people have, and we know people like that today, right? They get everything they want. Everything they want, way more than they need. And they get everything they want because they have the resources to get those things. Well, what Jesus is saying, it doesn't matter what mm-hmm. you got. It's not about that. It's about the relationship.
Yeah.
And there is just one way. And
that's, you know, we talked yesterday morning, and it kind of makes my brain hurt when I think about this. But, you know, it says, but with man, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. But then you contrast that with, we were talking about the lady who was unclean, who pushed through the crowd to touch the tassel of Jesus, mm-hmm. and she became clean. And when Jesus turned around and knelt down and spoke to her, she was basically saying, you did this. But Jesus said, no, it's not I, but it's your faith that cleansed you. And so it makes your brain hurt when you think about that dynamic, that it's, yes, it is God, but it's also what we do with that.
Yeah.
Where is our faith placed? Because you can know God is God, but still things are impossible. It's when you put your faith in God and you act on faith and you step out of your comfort zone and you step out in obedience. That's where the impossible becomes possible. And I don't know. It was just we actually, in Sunday school yesterday morning, we actually played that clip from The Chosen. Where she pushes through the crowd.
Oh, that was a great scene.
I mean, it'll bring you to tears almost every time you watch it because it's so powerful.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Hebrews 12:1-2, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne.
And she I've never heard that version before.
I haven't either, but I love it.
You know what the translation is?
I don't.
Did she say?
I don't know. And I meant to go back and look to see what that was because I really love that translation.
Yeah.
We've gone through this verse a gazillion times, but we've never.
You don't usually see the word huge.
Yeah.
You don't see that in the New King James Version.
Yeah, it's probably the New Living Translation.
But it is. Like I mean, it kind of brings a not a different perspective, but a more. It's just easier to read this version. So I've never read that version.
Isn't it funny, too, that she's talking, it talks about the sin that so easily trips us up. It uses the word trips us up.
James is ensnares.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, but in this particular podcast, what was our post of the week was her tripping on a sidewalk.
Right? That's true. Yeah, that was Madonna's post.
That's right. So, and then here we are. So, I love it. I love this. Yeah, what we have to do is we have to stay away from those things. I talked last week about, you know, how I can't go on the X platform because in 5 minutes my blood pressure goes up. So you know what that means? That means that little icon that's on my phone doesn't get tapped very often because I don't need to because I need to stay away from that because it's not good for me.
You know, I've had all of them off since January 1 and I mean, a lot of what we do is on social platforms and I can get on them on my computer. But man, it's been incredible, you know. Every once in a while somebody says, "Did you see?" And I'm like, "Oh, I don't have it on my phone, but I can go find it on the computer." It was the right move for me.
Yeah, it's good stuff. Well, I've been trying to spend a lot of time on Strava lately, really paying attention to what our folks are doing on Strava. Yeah. So that's my social media thing that I've been doing. So that's not so bad. It's a lot easier. You can scroll through everything pretty quickly on Strava. So
well, here before long, we're gonna have our own app.
That's right.
We have our own app now that has a social platform. But I say it every week, Dean.
Yeah,
you're not in a lot of these meetings. These guys know what they're doing.
Yeah,
Brian and his team. It's just they're so far over my head. I just feel very ignorant when I'm on the phone with him.
I'm excited about it.
And Brian's listening. Brian's running. So, Brian, if you're out there, kudos to you and your team. You're doing a great job. If you could get that app done next week, that would be great.
That'd be great. Well, I thought about this with it in relation to this verse. Have you ever run on a track after you ran on an uneven surface? You know, you run, maybe you run on the road or you run on a trail or something, and then you run straight to the track. And the track just feels like you're gliding.
It's kind of like being on a gravel road for 30 miles and then hitting asphalt.
Yes.
This is incredible.
It feels so good, doesn't it? And to me, getting rid of the sin in your life is a lot like going from that really uneven gravel road to that nice, smooth pavement. Things will... Now, you still have to run. You still have to do your part. But things get much smoother when you focus on God. All of a sudden, you have that nice, smooth track in front of you. Again, it doesn't mean it gets easy. But we have to look for those things. When we're purposefully running on that gravel road instead of that nice smooth pavement, we need to change that up.
Sure.
Hebrews 13:16, and do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices God is pleased. I added this scripture. She only had two scripture references here, so I added this one. So I hope that's okay, Madonna. She talks about helping people with Run for God classes. And you know what I like about those classes is that very often it's the person that teaches the class that has changed the most.
Mm-hmm. We hear it over and over.
We do. We do. But there are sacrifices, right? It says in this scripture, for with such sacrifices, God is pleased. He's pleased with us in our sacrifices. Now, I hear all the time about how I make the excuse. I don't have time for that mm-hmm. because it's not convenient for me.
Sure.
When it's something and it's a kingdom related thing, I need to make time for mm-hmm. those things. And we can't just do the things that are convenient. A lot of times when it's time to share Christ with somebody, and it's convenient, a lot of times we'll do that. Mm-hmm. But what are we doing when it's not convenient and God is still telling us we need to do it?
Sure.
I think is the big thing. And again, I'm not trying to throw stones or anything, but we have people all the time that say, I can't do a Run for God class. Mm-hmm. And you get the feeling in the things that they're saying that it feels like God's urging them, but they don't have time for it. It's not convenient enough. And sometimes you just got to get outside. You got to get outside that comfort zone. You got to get outside it needs to be convenient thought.
We were talking this morning about, you know, coming to this ministry as a seasoned runner. How do those people see this ministry? And they see it one way.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they teach a class, they see it completely different. And it's because... You know, it's just like you self-admittedly, when you were pre-Run for God, you didn't think about the people in the back. Not that you didn't care about them.
Right.
You just didn't think about them. Mm-hmm. You won the race or you placed high, you went and got your medal and you were home, and it was a couple hours later, many hours later, before some of the people in the back came through.
Mm-hmm.
But now that you're in Run for God, you've taught classes, you work here now, but... Take working here out of it. You came to this realization before you ever came to work here.
Mm-hmm.
When you started teaching Run for God classes, your whole perspective changed. It happened with me.
Yep.
You start to see what those people in the back, the gravity of what they're actually doing.
Yep.
It's way more than you being in the front or me being middle pack. It's way more than what we're doing.
Yep.
It's Hebrews 12:1 coming to life with those people in the back.
Mm-hmm.
There are so many things that are holding them back and snares and trips and they're having to battle through every bit of that. And it's why at our races now, I will never do a race where the finish line isn't louder for that last person than it is for the first.
Right.
It's great to celebrate the person in the front, no question. But it makes you cry.
Yep.
Celebrating the people in the back.
Absolutely. Well, Madonna didn't actually submit questions. She submitted statements.
Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah.
She said, we are put on this earth to help others. God doesn't care what our job title is. He wants to know how we treated others.
Well put.
Yeah. Isn't that's great. I kind of wrote down, we're not here to accumulate all the wealth we can, although there's nothing wrong with making money. We're not here to have fun and do what we want to do, although there's nothing wrong with having fun. We're not here to work ourselves to death, although there is honor in work. We're not even here to go for a run every day, although God loves us runners just as much as anyone else. We are here to serve Him wherever we are. You say, you know, people say, "Oh, I'm not in ministry." Yes, you are. Mm-hmm. Yes, you are. You are Absolutely. In ministry, and your mission field's right in front of you wherever you are. And there are people out there that need to hear the gospel. And
let's put it this way: you're either helping the kingdom or you're hurting the kingdom. Mm. There's no in between.
Yeah,
you're either helping or you're hurting. Boy, that's hard to hear.
That is,
but
hard
it's
to hear.
Very true.
Yep.
God doesn't want lukewarm. That's kind of lukewarm.
Yeah.
When you feel like, well, I'm not in ministry. It's the preacher's job, or it's you're riding that fence, and that's a dangerous place to be.
My fear is that one day that there'll be somebody who a friend of mine who is not in heaven, mm-hmm. who is asking the question, why didn't he share with me? And that haunts me sometimes.
It does.
And but we got to be vigilant about it. Second one, I want to learn more about God every day. Hopefully that's a goal for all of us, right? And the question is, are we really striving for that, right? Do we go looking for new insight into God every day? I mean, I could just asking that question makes me feel guilty, mm-hmm. you know, because I obviously, you know, here's the thing that I'm really struck by nowadays is we were talking about this in our Sunday school class yesterday, how much easier it is to learn about God today than it was when I was a kid. You know, when I was a kid, you had to go out and you had to buy books, mm-hmm. take them home, scour those books and try to get some insight. Today, you got all this information at your fingertips mm-hmm. all the time. And yet we seem less faithful today than we were back when I was a kid. And it made me think
there's so many other things to put your faith into nowadays.
Well, and that's true.
At your fingertips, yeah. To your point.
It made me think about some of these countries where it's not okay to mm-hmm. worship God and how committed those people are.
Sure.
When it's hard, we seem to be more committed, but when it becomes easy, we get less committed just because we take it for granted. And
Dean, that'll preach right there. There's so many sermons in that statement.
Yeah.
That do hard things.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm. Last one. I want my family and friends to have a relationship with God. Mm. Mm-mm. How many family members and friends do we have who need to hear about Jesus? That's the question to ask ourselves. And when I ask that question, I'm sure somebody pops in your mind, right? Mm-hmm. There's always somebody. And I challenge you today to go to that person, to call that person, to contact, whatever. Send them a message that just says Jesus loves you. Mm-hmm. Get a conversation started. Whatever. Just something.
Or be so bold as to ask the question,
yes,
where are you going to spend eternity?
That's right.
I've asked many of my friends that question, and it's uncomfortable, but it's... And sometimes I get the answer that I wonder, are they just saying that? But I love Francis of Assisi, you know, or he didn't really actually say it. I learned through the editing process of one of our books, but it's attributed to Francis of Assisi, preach the gospel and if necessary, use words. Mm. I don't like that sentiment because we have to use words.
Yep.
We're to live out our faith through the things we do. Yes. But Jesus called us to go and make disciples. You can't make disciples if you don't talk to them.
That's right.
Go ask those around you that you love. Ask them the hard questions. Do hard things. We just said it's worth it. Are you going to get shot down sometimes? Absolutely. But just like Mark Elho said years ago, we're just the mailman.
Well, and what may happen is you might get shot down, but you know what may happen too? they may think about that conversation an hour later and go,
or 5 years later.
Or 5 years later, yes.
They won't forget it. That's they right. won't forget that conversation.
That's right. And it could lead to, it could be the difference in their life.
Mm-hmm.
There is no better way to start the day than in the Word. Our Bible in a Year challenge is a great way to start the day in the Word as I read through the entire Bible in 365 episodes. I also share running and walking tips each day, as well as encouraging quotes. Choose the self-paced challenge so that you can go at your pace. You must be a Run Club member for access to this exciting challenge. So, if you're not a member, sign up today and get started. If you are a member, what are you waiting for? All right, we're back. Telomeres. You know what those are?
I've never heard that
word. Never heard that term before? Well, all right, I'm going to try to talk about them. I don't know how accurate I am, but this is my understanding, okay? So if you're a doctor out there and you know what these things are or whatever, don't give me too hard a time, okay? But as I understand it, telomeres are these things. They're at the end of our chromosomes, and as we age, telomeres get shorter. And as they get shorter, eventually what some people think is that we get to a point where basically we run out of them, and once they get so short that they're basically gone, we die. Our body quits functioning because it can't function without them. And so, again, I'm not a scientist, but I'm always amazed at reading about these kinds of things and how the body works. You know, because God just built this unbelievable machine that we live in. But we're still learning about these things. It's amazing that we still learn about these things and still don't know so much mm-hmm. about the body. But they did a study recently and showed that if you run for 75 minutes a week, hour and 15 minutes a week, your telomeres look 12 years younger than someone who runs less than 10 minutes a week or somebody that doesn't run at all. Theoretically, you should live 12 years longer if all of this science is true, if you run 75 minutes a week. That may be part of the reason why runners live longer.
Hmm.
Isn't that interesting?
Mm-hmm.
Now, this could be backwards science. It could be just that people who run are generally healthier people.
Right.
And so, but either way, they didn't measure walkers in this case, but I would think there'd be a similar benefit
sure.
for walkers, wouldn't you? Yeah. We've said a few times boosting your VO2 max lengthens your life. But maybe that's not a heart or a lung thing. Maybe boosting your VO2 max is just keeping your telomeres long. And that's the whole
story. I'm just going to stick with the study that we all know to be true. If you get moving multiple times a week, the studies show that you're going to live longer.
Yep. I'm going to stick with.
We're just going to keep it simple.
I'm going to stick with. In the Bible, it says we need to take care of our bodies, and taking care of our bodies means getting some good exercise.
And so, you know, it's so funny how you know we talked earlier about the people that say, "Well, if a bear's, you know, if you see me running a bear's." You know what those same people say? The people that are in Scripture, and I can't even remember the Scripture now, but it says basically the verse that says, "Only a fool runs."
Yeah,
you know you know that is only in one version of the Bible that you've never even heard of? It's like one of the New British Standard New Living Translation of. It's one weird translation of the Bible where it says that, and so because I looked it up one time, I was like, because I've had so many people tell me that, and I'm like, I gotta look this up. It's not in any of the normal translations of the Bible that you read. It does not say that.
That's funny. That's hilarious.
So now I tell everybody that. I'm like, you're reading that backwoods version of the Bible that nobody reads.
Well, that's just one more study to tell us running's good for us. You know what I haven't seen yet? I haven't seen the study that says running's bad for you. I haven't seen that one yet.
I don't think you're going to find that one.
No.
I say that. You'll probably find it. Somebody's probably...
Well, I've seen the ones that say that you can run too much. I've seen those.
Right. The people that send me those verses, they probably did a study and says that running is bad for you because the Bible says it too.
Probably right.
The Bible does not say it.
All right. It's a time for Dean's Thoughts. That's a time when I share something I've written about the intersection between running and faith. Well, is there an imprint of a scene that never goes away in your head? I like to call them mountaintop experiences. This one's called The Mountaintop. I remember the first time I walked up on the Grand Canyon. It was what I might call a mountaintop experience. Speaking of mountaintops, I vividly remember driving through the Rocky Mountains National Park. It was beautiful. There were views I will never forget. I also remember crossing the finish line in the 2013 Myrtle Beach Marathon. I was in third place, 3 minutes behind the leader at the halfway point, but a good second half catapulted me into the lead with a half mile to go. I almost felt bad for the guy I passed with 3 minutes left in the race. But that finish line was every bit as memorable as the view of the Grand Canyon. And let me tell you, meeting my firstborn son for the very first time was even more special. We all love mountaintop experiences. As a runner, there's a good chance you have had at least one great day. Maybe it was a PR when you didn't expect it. Or maybe it was simply running for 20 minutes straight in week 8 of the 5K challenge. If you've been a runner for more than a few minutes, you probably even have a vivid memory of a great workout you completed. I can still remember specific workouts I did in 1983. I remember them like I do the Rocky Mountains. We all love mountaintop experiences. But that's not where we grow. As much as I'd like to credit that 2013 Myrtle Beach Marathon win to the flashy Yasso 800s workout that I did a few weeks prior to the race, that one day experience was built from the grind of the prior year. It is on those 90-degree days that we are refined. It is when we get the 8-miler in when it's raining and that we say and we slay the mental monster that lies between us and the mountaintop. It is in the tough days that we get better. It's in the valleys that we grow, not on the mountaintops. We certainly can't be blamed for craving the mountaintop. They are important days in our lives. But we cannot get to those days without spending time in the valley. So it is important that we not only recognize those days in the valley, but that we embrace those days. The next time you are lamenting a bad day, and let's face it, we all do it, remember that it is not that it is that very day, along with many more, that will take you to the mountaintop. Think of it like a road trip. When Debbie and I drove out to Colorado and through the Rocky Mountain National Park, we drove for miles through the flattest land I'd ever seen in Kansas. That's not to talk down about Kansas either, because without Kansas, there is no road to Colorado. Both states were equally important in getting to the day we threw a snowball in June in the Rocky Mountains. Be thankful for your ordinary days and your rough days. Without them, you won't grow. Without them, you won't see the mountaintop. In contemplating the mountaintop, I can't help but think about those times when I all but saw God. I remember a time when I was running early one Saturday morning on a crisp, cool day. It was dead quiet and still. And right in the middle of my 12-mile run, I stopped. I don't ever stop, but I did that day. I looked at the amazing creation God had made and thought about how special it was that I was right in the middle of it all, and that in that moment, I realized that God thought of me as the most important thing in that beautiful landscape. He was there with me that morning, and I felt him. But I could never have had that experience if I hadn't gone through all the days prior to it. Not only did I have to work to get myself into shape to run the 12 miles I ran that morning, but I had to spend countless hours communing with God to bring me to that morning. It all came together in one incredibly poignant and special 2 minutes of time. It was a mountaintop morning. So what are you going to do? Are you going to whine about your next bad run? Are you going to look back at it as a necessary step to the mountaintop? The decision is really yours. Make your choice today and make it easier on yourself tomorrow.
Man, that's a great story, Dean. It just keeps going with the theme that we've been talking about this whole podcast.
Yeah.
Doing the hard things.
Yeah. Yeah, the Grand, you know, I remember the Grand Canyon. It was really amazing looking at the Grand Canyon. But you know what the most vivid memory I have of something that just blew me away?
What's that?
Was when I was a kid. I was 8, 9 years old. And my uncle took me to we lived in Florida. He took me to a spring training baseball game. I had never been in a baseball, I'd never been in any kind of a stadium prior to that. And we walked through that portal into the stadium. And that was the most magical vision I'd ever.
The grandness of it, yeah.
Yes, it was so, and I'll never, ever forget that moment of walking through there. Because I think the difference was, with the Grand Canyon, I had an expectation, right? There was a certain expectation I had when I saw it. Now, it was more incredible than you can imagine when you get there, but you still had an expectation. The baseball thing, I had no expectation. I was a kid. I had nothing. I wasn't even thinking about it. I was just thinking, I'm doing this cool thing with my uncle. And it was magical.
I think the thing that still gets me, and we're actually planning one right now, but we like to go on cruises every now and then. And to get out in the ocean and to be on a boat where you can't see land,
yeah.
To me, that gets me every time. Just the vastness. I mean, because, you know, sometimes we feel like the world is just what's right here around us. But you get out there and you realize, I mean, we're just a nothing in this world. And and then that really hits home that God formed us, this little speck in the middle of the ocean on a boat with hundreds of other people or thousands of other people. God formed us and he loves us and he loves everybody. I don't know, it's just the grandness of being out in the middle of the ocean that's, it gets me every time.
Yeah, well, and it's just like that though, in that grandness of that ocean and all the things under it that you can't see, right?
Sure.
All of those creatures and all of the things that are there and all of that water and that, even that great ship, the most important thing to God there are the people that are on that ship in the middle of all of that grandness. It's just, it's really amazing when we think about how big a deal it is that God loves us like he does. You know, this past Wednesday, we watched that video on Inky Johnson. Inky Johnson is, he was a guy who worked his whole life to get into the NFL. Very poor family. He grew up in a house with 14 people in a two-bedroom house. Didn't have hardly anything. He worked his tail off. He talks about he would go to the football field to do workouts with his mother. And his mother would sit in the car with the headlights on the car so he could see enough to do a workout. That's how driven he was. And he worked his whole life to get to the NFL. He was in his senior season at the University of Tennessee, and he was just this great athlete. He was going to be a first-round draft pick. I mean, he already gotten letters saying he was going to be a first-round draft pick. It was a foregone conclusion. All he had to do was get through his senior season. And in one moment, the last 2 minutes of a basically meaningless game, he went to tackle somebody and got hit, and his whole life changed in that moment. He couldn't get up. He couldn't move. And to this day, his right arm is paralyzed, and he can't use his right arm. And he talks about how that injury, it was devastating for him at the time because he had worked so hard all those years, but he said he wouldn't change anything. Because of that injury, his father was saved.
Sure.
Because of that injury, so many great things have happened because of his injury and his. And that's where, gosh, we have to realize that no matter what's going on around us, no matter how good, bad things are, these valleys are so, so important to our lives, but the people around us as well.
Yeah, I mean, we've made the comment before. I don't even remember who said it, but I clung on to it. I didn't come up with this comment, but it's the comment that the measure of a man is not what he does in the valleys. Because we all know what we're going to do in the valleys. We're going to draw on God, but it's what we do on the mountaintops. The valleys are so important, but the valleys are where it's easy to cling to God. But what do you do on the mountaintop?
Yeah.
Are you continuing to give credit and cling to God even on the mountaintop? And that's, you know, sometimes you may need to create valleys. Maybe You know, that's why running is so good, because it just automatically creates those valleys for us sometimes. Mm-hmm. But the mountaintops can be a dangerous place. It makes me wonder if that's what Jesus was partially talking about when he said it's harder for a rich man to get to heaven than it is for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. It's, you know, we associate wealth with being on the mountaintop. Mm-hmm. And the mountaintop's a dangerous place to be.
Yep.
One, because people are trying to knock you off that mountaintop. But two, you can get complacent and think that you don't need God. And that's not a place you want to be.
No, it's not. Well, every week I share a reason why running and or walking is so awesome. And this week I said, most of your friends are great. If you're a runner, most of your friends are great. Because a lot of times, if you're a runner, most of your friends are runners too. Or at least some of them are runners. And if you have a running friend, they have more energy. They're more willing to do stuff. They're used to getting outside their comfort zone, so you can do some fun stuff. They're not lazy, I guess is what I'm saying. So you always have somebody to do some fun stuff with. And that's pretty awesome. Mm-hmm. Maybe you can go skydiving with your running friend, because that's the kind of stuff runners would do together. All right. We have a trivia question for this week. And this one's a relatively simple question, but there's lots of answers for this one. So here's the question. Name one scientific reason that runners are smarter than average people.
I'm glad you said scientific, because there's a lot of people out there that would say, we're not smarter. We're running. Why are we running?
Yeah, you're right. You're right.
On purpose, as Madonna would say.
That's right. If you know the answer to that question, send it to dean@runforgod.com. And if you're the first person, you will win $20 off in the Run for God store. All right. How about a motivational thought of the week? It comes from Dolly Parton. She said, if you don't like the road you're walking, start paving another one. Isn't that great?
Yeah.
We have choices. And if you don't like how unhealthy you are, then change it. If you want to spend more time in prayer, Bible study, then do it. It's just one step at a time and one load of asphalt at a time.
Absolutely.
Right? Absolutely. All right. Well, we appreciate you joining us. As always, we ask you share this podcast with other people. Spread the word around. Join the YouTube channel. Rate and review the podcast.
All those things. Yeah.
Yeah.
It all helps.
Absolutely. And spread the word, because the more we spread the word, the more people get to hear Madonna's story.
Right.
And how God has made a difference in her story. And people begin to wonder, I wonder if he can do that for me. And we all know he can. And so the more we share it, the better off we are. All right. Until next week, may God bless every step of every run and or walk. Go out there and shine your light.
Good job, Dean.
For more information about the Run for God ministry, go to runforgod.com. If you have questions about your salvation, click on the Peace with God tab. There's nothing more important. Thanks for joining us today.